The grim work of recovering bodies from the Sewol-ho ferry proceeds, with the official death toll reaching 159. Divers face a more complicated phase as they must now rip through the cabin walls in their efforts. Thousands come to pay respects to the victims at a group memorial altar at the Ansan Olympic Memorial Hall. Grief pours out as schoolmates and others pay tribute. Young volunteers and fellow peers give their time and effort to do anything they can. Donations flood in from other high school peers and university students as the world prays for the victims. On Korea Today, Thursday, April 24th, 2014.
From Arirang News, this is Korea Today.
Welcome to Korea Today. It's the ninth day since the Korean passenger ferry sank off the nation's southwestern coast. It's taken a toll physically and emotionally on the families, the survivors, the rescuers, as well as the entire nation.
That's right. Koreans across the country are trying to cope with the situation, and there is a movement online and offline of putting up yellow ribbons that symbolize the thoughts and prayers that many have for the victims and their families.
Now, it's also the physical ribbons that are being put up, but also pictures for profile pictures that people are replacing their profiles with. And it started with the wish for the safe return and still carries that message of hope. A small movement for a big miracle.
Mm-hmm. And we're all wearing yellow ribbons to share those prayers and thoughts with the families of the victims. Though hope is fading that there may be additional survivors in the frigid waters, search and rescue operations continue as there are still 143 passengers unaccounted for. Let's go right over to our correspondent Hwang Seong-hee, who's covering the story for us at the Paengmokhang Harbor, the nearest port from where the accident took place. Seong-hee, it's yet another day, but the chances are they'll recover more bodies at this point. What can you tell us?
That's right, Minjung. We're now into our ninth day of search and rescue operations, but still not a single survivor has been found since the ferry capsized. Now, the official confirmed death toll has risen overnight to 159. Most of the bodies recovered yesterday and overnight were high school students. Now, family members of the missing who have been camping out here at the Paengmokhang Harbor are really clinging onto their last shreds of hope, but they are growing very, very restless as time passes. More and more families have been coming to the harbor lately with the rise in the death toll as they try to identify with their own eyes their children's bodies. Now, even in the early hours of the morning, I saw many parents gathered around a list that describes the retrieved bodies, trying to match the descriptions with their loved ones. Minjung?
I can't even begin to fathom what it must feel like trying to match the descriptions of the bodies to their loved ones. Now, for the rescue operations, I believe divers are entering a new phase in the search.
That's right. The rescue team will begin their attempts to enter the center area of the fourth floor vessel, the cabins, where the cabins are, as we speak at this hour. Now, that's where most of the Danwon High School students were staying in the ferry, and that's where most of the missing passengers are believed to be. So we will be waiting to see if there are any survivors there. Like you said, over 140 likely remain missing inside the sunken ship, and most of them are high school students. Now, today's rescue operations will include the largest number of rescue personnel yet. The rescue teams have been focusing their search on the third and fourth floors of the vessel, and so far they said they have not found any air pockets. Now, unfortunately, this greatly reduces the chances of finding survivors in the sunken ship. Minjung?
Mm-hmm. But it seems like there are still messages of hope and support that can be found on site over there.
Well, behind me you can see yellow ribbons tied praying for the safe return of the missing passengers on the Seoro ferry. I see you guys are also wearing the same yellow ribbons. Now, it's been a week since the tragedy, and messages of support have been arriving to this Paengmokhang harbor for those still missing in the sunken ship from across the nation. The messages said, "We love you all and that miracles will happen." This has been Hwang Sang-hee reporting from Paengmokhang harbor.
Not only is it the ninth day of rescue operations, but the parents of the missing are now into the ninth day of uncertainty of the status of their sons and daughters who were on board the Seoro ferry. The families have been huddled in a gymnasium near the accident site in Jindo, where our Hwang Jie joins us live. Jie, good morning.
Young, it's relatively calm here at the moment, with families waking up and hoping that today will finally be the day that they will get to hear some news about their families. You can feel the sadness in the air and how hard it is for families to cope with the passing hours. Doctors at the gymnasium are saying that the bodies, the families actually, are in a state of shock and deep mourning, which are resulting in headaches and exhaustion. They add that while now is an unbearable time for the families, mentally the symptoms of depression could recur after 2 or 3 months. There are now noticeably fewer families here at the Jindo Gymnasium as more bodies are being discovered and identified. The families are leaving to tend to their lost loved ones at Paengmokhang Harbor and to the hospital. The others left here are going back and forth from the gymnasium to the harbor about 2 times a day. A father that I talked to yesterday, that he said that he realizes that his daughter is gone and that he just now hopes that he could find her body so that she can rest in peace. Young?
You know, Chia, I can't even begin to imagine how difficult it must be in that situation. Now, there are still some 140 people that are still unaccounted for, and our thoughts go out to their families there. Now, we hear the government is deploying more resources for the transport of recovered bodies.
Yes, a representative of the families said yesterday that the bodies will be transferred from the Paengmokhang Harbor to the hospitals using 4 military helicopters. They add that he added that they will quicken the process of bodies being sent back home. The families can also ride together. While the whole country is hopefully waiting for news of survivors, along with the families here, hundreds of volunteer workers came to the Jindo Gymnasium to support the families here and to encourage the families desperately waiting for their missing ones to stay strong. This has been Hwang Jie reporting live from the Jindo Gymnasium.
As those anxious families wait for news of their loved ones, those who've already gotten their bitter closure are saying their last goodbyes at a group memorial hall set up in Ansan, the city that's been most affected by this disaster. We'll go to our Shin Se-min, who joins us live from the memorial hall. Se-min, I hear people are lining up to pay their tribute.
Yes, Minjung, that's right. A total of 13,000 mourners just yesterday have visited here at Ansan Olympic Memorial Hall to pay their last tribute to those who have deceased. Lines of mourners and visitors reached all the way to the entrance of this memorial hall just yesterday, all day long. Mourners lined up in silence with flowers in their hands to say their last goodbyes and also offered the white flowers. Even at this early hour, you can see people coming in groups of 3 or 4, writing letters and notes that dot the doors and walls outside the memorial hall. The local government here has also set up a message service so that those who cannot come in person can send text messages of condolences. The total number of messages received cannot be tallied at this point, as the system was overloaded with an outpouring of grief. But it's thought more than 20,000 text messages were sent from all over the country. Also, Prime Minister Chung Hong-un has directed the Ministry of Security and Public Administration to install group memorial halls all over the country so that people people nationwide can pay their respect to the victims.
Mm-hmm. It seems like many people are asking the city of Seoul to set up a memorial altar at the Seoul Plaza as well. Now, in the meantime, more bodies have been retrieved and they are being transported to the city of Ansan. Now, how is the city managing the situation?
Yes, funeral halls and hospitals here in the city of Ansan has been experiencing a morbid saturation point as more bodies continue to arrive here. Local hospitals and funeral halls has been receiving a lot of bodies and have been struggling to cope with the number of victims who are being sent here. Unfortunately, this has been leaving many families on waiting list for empty funeral hall. Officials here in the city are working to expand facilities while securing funeral halls in the nearby cities like Siheung and Anyang. Meanwhile, 12 more victims are expected to be released from Ansan soon. And I'll bring you more update at the end of the show. And this has been Shin Se-min reporting live from Ansan Olympic Memorial Hall.
And with the death toll continuing to rise, families are growing furious and angry of this man-made disaster. Investigation into those charged responsible is intensifying. And for more details on this, we're joined by Connie Kim in our news center. Connie?
Good morning, Young. Most of the 11 crew members that have been taken into custody could be charged with negligent homicide, according to the joint investigative body by the prosecution and the police. Now, there were 15 crew members in total, all rescued, and seven of them got on the very first rescue boat sent by the Coast Guard. Investigators believe the crew members had room to at least try to save the passengers. And during the investigation process, some of the crew have reportedly shown signs of regret, admitting to their mistakes and saying they should have taken rescue measures. The owner of this Haewoodo ferry, the Cheongaejin Marine Company, is also under fire as well. Prosecutors seem to think the fundamental reason for the sinking lies with the ferry operator. A joint investigation team on Wednesday raided several offices and the homes of the Cheongaejin Marine Company owner, Yoo Byung-an, and his company headquarters here in Seoul. Yoo's two sons, the biggest shareholders of the ferry's operating company, and the whole family now has been banned from traveling out of the country since Sunday.
Now, Connie, there's been some reports that North Korea sent a message of condolence to the victims of the Haewoodo ferry disaster yesterday. Can you tell us a bit more about this?
You're right, Young. Going into the eighth day of the search for missing passengers on board the sunken Haewoodo ferry, the North Korean Red Cross sent over a message of condolence to those affected by the accident through the inter-Korean channel at the truce village of Panmunjom yesterday. The message from Pyongyang expressed deep sorrow for the passengers who have lost their lives or are still missing. Now, this is the first time the communist state sent such a message since 2003, when nearly 200 people were killed on a subway train in the city of Daegu.
It seems that it will take more time to find all the missing passengers, but once the search and rescue operations are completed, or once the families of the missing give their consent, the salvage of the sunken ferry will begin. There are already five salvage cranes on standby at the site, and a floating dock, which is described as a so-called moving shipyard, is preparing to be sent to the waters off Jindo Island as well. But many experts are saying that the salvage of the Haewoodo ferry will not be a simple task. Let's take a look at this next report to find out how the operation is expected to be carried out.
With families of missing passengers requesting officials to conclude search operations soon, discussion on how to salvage the wreckage is expected to gain more momentum. The large ferry weighs over 6,000 tons on its own, but with added weight, it's expected to exceed 10,000 tons. Salvaging the 7,900-ton ferry Ariake, which capsized off the coast of Japan in 2009, was a challenging operation because of the cargo that had shifted to one side, a similar situation with this Haewoodo ferry. It took over a year to salvage the ship with cranes after cutting it into four pieces. Then how about operations for this Haewoodo ferry? Currently, there are five cranes on standby near the accident site, including an 8,000-ton crane, the largest in the country. Floating docks are set to be brought in as well, but the salvage process is likely to face a rough start because the ferry now lies upside down. Salvaging the ship as is may cause damage to the upper levels of the vessel. The safest and most realistic method being considered is to use both cranes and floating docks at the same time. First, chains would go around the vessel, then lift bags filled with air would be installed to slowly put the ship on its right side up, while pulling it closer to the surface. Then, the floating docks can be taken underwater to support the vessel from below and push it up. The government continues to look through all options to identify the best method. It has requested cranes and barges from China while asking the Japanese shipbuilder that initially built the Seoro ferry for assistance.
So, looking at the case of the Japanese capsized ferry Ariake, it seems that salvaging the Seoro ferry will also take months, if not years. Now, for an expert's take on how the salvage operation will likely take place, we have Captain John Noble, a British marine salvage expert, joining us on the phone. Thanks for your time this morning, Captain.
Good morning.
So, first of all, could you walk us through the expected procedures of salvaging the Seoro ferry?
Yes, the first thing that they will do, and they've probably already started, is doing a detailed salvage survey of the upturned hull on the bottom. And when that's completed, they will then meet with the various authorities and decide what is the most efficient way of salvaging or removing the wreck of the hull. And I note that there are plenty of cranes in the vicinity, so there is more than enough lifting capacity. They may decide to make the ship upright whilst she is still on the seabed. That would then make lifting easier and transferring the ship onto the submersible dock much more easy.
Mm-hmm. Now, you talked about the submersible dock, but many experts here in Korea are saying that using the floating dock will be the best way to lift the ship. But Korea hasn't been using this method in the past. What's your opinion on that?
Well, I'm inclined to agree that it is probably the best way of doing it. And whilst there may not be the expertise in Korea, there is international expertise, and interestingly, this is the method they intend to use for phase two of the Costa Concordia salvage. So there is a precedent. It's not easy. Please don't misunderstand me. This is not an easy operation, but it is within, if there is international help and experience available, that might assist the Korean salvage company in achieving its aim.
Mm-hmm. In line with the previous question, now, considering the size or weight of the ship and how it has completely flipped over as it sank, what kind of special equipment or personnel are needed in the salvage?
Well, ideally, you would want people there who have done this sort of thing before. And I know internationally there are people available, and I'm quite sure the Korean salvage company and other Korean experts would call upon that aid, because it would certainly make the operation much safer and much more certain to be successful.
Mm-hmm. And as we saw in the report, it took the Japanese capsized ship about a year to be salvaged. And in the case of the torpedo South Korean warship Chunan, which weighed only about a sixth of the Seoro ferry, it took about a month to pull it out of the water. So how long do you think will it take to bring the ferry up to the surface, and what could be some potential obstacles?
Well, much of the question of how long it will take really depends on what resources are going to be used and maintained on site. And if the weather is good and things go well, it could be done within 1 or 2 months. But much depends on the approach taken in Korea with this very, very sensitive wreck. So there are other issues yet to be considered. The purely practical point of view, with the resources that are currently there, 1 to 2 months is not looking unrealistic.
Right. So the weather conditions will also be a big factor in the salvage operation as well. And it seems that the salvage operation should be planned out thoroughly in advance so that there will be no hesitation or confusion in what will become a lengthy procedure. Well, we thank you for your insight this morning, Captain.
Thank you very much.
Good morning. Now let's run through the front pages of your newspapers. And continuing on from yesterday, a lot of the local papers today have stories on Yoo Byung-won, the real owner of Cheongye-jin Marine Company, the operator of the sunken ferry Seowol-ho. And today we'll begin with Jungang Ilbo's headline here. It reads, Yoo Byung-won spends roughly $36 million to reconstruct Temo Marine Company, worth almost $540 million. Now, prosecutors yesterday raided Cheongye-jin Marine Company, residences of Yoo Byung-won's family, as well as his affiliate companies, some 20 locations, as the subheadlines say, as part of a probe into allegations that Yoo was involved in various financial irregularities. Now, the paper says that Yoo constructed the very expensive Temo Kingdom by using Gwonpa believers, or the religious groups believed to be linked with the family, those part of the Evangelical Baptist Church in Korea that I talked about yesterday, as well as borrowed names in order to build Temo Group, which took a decade's time. And it only took him $36 million to build the gigantic group worth $540 million, leading the paper to raise some questions about the legality of business operations. And scooting to Gyeongyang Shinmun, this heartbreaking front page image, you can just feel the pain that the student is going through. The title of the picture says, students break down in sorrow at the memorial altar. Mourners paid respect to the ferry victims at a memorial altar in Ansan of Gyeonggi-do province yesterday. The nationwide sense of loss and grief is affecting the daily lives of many in our society. And going to Dongwa-ilbo, the top story is once again regarding the Cheongye-jin Marine Company. The headline says, investigation into the special treatment for Cheongye-jin affiliates in receiving loans worth $190 million. Now, one focus of the investigative agencies is on the possibility of some sort of special treatment that Cheongye-jin's affiliate companies may have gotten when receiving such heavy loans. Another focus is whether the Yoo family reacquired the shares of Temo Group below market price through complex cross-holding of shares. And we'll take a look at this headline below the image here separately regarding North Korea for a change of topic. And it's regarding efforts by South Korea and China to persuade the North to put a stop to its nuclear ambitions. The headline says Chinese President Xi Jinping says he will try utmost to dissuade North Korea from conducting a nuclear test. Now, as you heard earlier in the program, President Park Geun-hye yesterday asked Chinese President Xi Jinping to persuade North Korea not to conduct a nuclear test amid growing concerns that Pyongyang may push ahead with a fourth atomic test. Now, during a phone call between the two leaders, Park made the request, and in return, Xi told Park that China also hopes to ease tensions on the Korean Peninsula and that the country is making the hardest efforts to help maintain peace and stability in the region, as China also poses the North's nuclear programs. Let's finally go on to the Economic Daily here, the Mail Business newspaper. And this one's on the mobile banking service. And the headline says, a surprise attack by the mobile banking service. The number of customers visiting bank branches here in the country has declined steeply as a smart banking service becomes more and more widespread. Now, 88% of banking transactions are executed based on non-face-to-face platforms, according to the Bank of Korea. However, here in the sub-headlines, what's interesting is that the local bank strategy for workforce and branches is going in the opposite direction as the number of workers in the industry went up by 25%. Now, this kind of bulky structure is problematic as banks are still sticking to offline platform even when attention is moving towards the smart banking service. And that was a look at your newspaper headlines for this Thursday. And coming up are the stock numbers from Wednesday.
We have mild and clear conditions ahead today, but things won't stay the same this weekend.
That's right. The window of opportunity is expected to begin closing after today. We're talking about conditions in Jindo Island. For more, Chun Sun-cho joins us. Good morning, Sun-cho.
Good morning, guys. Today is a continuation of mild conditions around Jindo Island, but also the last day of the NEAP tidal cycle, meaning the currents will pick up in speed again by tomorrow. And not only that, a nationwide rainfall is in the forecast this weekend, so today's search and rescue efforts will be exceptionally critical in the overall development of this operation. These are the predicted times for the turning of tide, when the currents begin to flow at the slowest, lasting for 2 hours. The conditions around Jindo Island today will stay mild, like the calm before the storm. You'll notice the figures remain the same in these two areas, the wind speed ranging from 4 to 7 meters per second, and waves up to half a meter in height. On Saturday, the waves will rise as high as 3 meters with strong gusts rocking the surface of the waters, so you'll see the scope of how severe this weekend's conditions are going to be. The water temperature drops to 12 degrees Celsius today as well. Now moving over to the rest of the peninsula, a high-pressure system over the East Sea will give us relatively clear skies nationwide, but a cloudy morning in Jeju. The mercury level rises up even higher than yesterday as warm air continues to blow from the southwest. Seoul's highs are 26, Jeju the coolest at 21, and Daegu the warmest at 28 degrees Celsius. Watch out for the big fluctuations between the highs and lows. The level of fine particulate matter in the atmosphere can be quite substantial in the capital area and Chungcheongdo provinces, and a dry weather warning has been issued in the central region and Jeollanam-do and Gyeongsangbuk-do provinces. This is all for me with the weather update.
And after reporting on the diving and rescue efforts for the last couple of days, Im Yoon-hee joins us back on the arts and culture front. Good morning, Yoon-hee.
Good morning, good morning. So the Korea National Opera has recently collaborated with artists from abroad to create a recreation of La Traviata, the opera. And so this time, the story is a little bit different than the usual romantic love story. So let's take a look.
It's another love story. A man falls for a woman. And they find themselves wildly in love. But this one has a tragic twist that even involves a violent and abrupt ending. La Traviata is a three-part opera by Giuseppe Verdi that has gained worldwide recognition. And even after 150 years, it's still being performed around stages everywhere.
This is my first expectation, is to make a violent show, violent to tell, because it's a violent story. Not only this, and usually you go, you have a beautiful, fantastic, very rich, very expensive set and costumes, and then you have a concert inside this. And this is exactly what I would like to avoid. Beautiful picture, but also strong and impressive staging.
La Traviata has been set in many different time periods, and this version takes place during the early 1950s, evoking the early Christian Dior new look for both costumes and stage settings. Alfredo falls madly in love with the beautiful Violetta. But Violetta isn't your girl next door. She's a courtesan. This time, however, she finds herself in love with Alfredo as well. Their relationship is scrutinized by many, including Alfredo's father, who eventually convinces her to leave Alfredo. When Alfredo finally returns to his love, she's already succumbing to the deadly grip of tuberculosis.
Verdi wrote the vocal lines in such a way that you can hear her pain, her physical pain, and you can hear her out of breath. It's all written in. It's tension and then release of tension, and tension and release of tension that I think really communicates physical anxiety and pain.
It's a flurry of beautiful music, grand voices, and luxurious costumes, as this tragic tale of Violetta and her love Alfredo harmoniously floats through the air.
So La Traviata at the Seoul Arts Center. How long has the Korea National Opera been a player in Korea in the opera scene?
Right, so they've been staging performances for about 50 years, and they've really developed as a company over the years. They range in performances anywhere from traditional, more classical European operas to original Korean operas as well.
But in comparison with Italy, for example, the Korean opera scene doesn't have such a long history.
Right. Asia in general has a pretty young history in terms of operas, but the director was telling me that it really is developed considering the time we've been given, and it really has potential to grow.
All right. Well, thank you very much for that report, Yuni.
My pleasure.
And still ahead on Korea Today, as the nation as well as people around the world pray for the victims of the Sewol-ho ferry, there are people that are sending in supplies. It's pouring in from around the country, with more than 90% coming from fellow students. We show you more on this up ahead on Korea Today.
Now, numerous memorial altars are being set up across the country, including the cities of Ansan and Incheon, to remember those who lost their lives in the Sewol-ho ferry sinking.
That's right. Many universities are also setting up memorial altars for their alumni, some of the teachers who went down with the ship. Now, thousands of people are lining up to pay their respects at the group memorial altar set up yesterday at the Ansan Olympic Memorial Hall. Our S.J. Lee was there. He joins us this morning. Good morning, S.J.
Good morning, guys. Now, yesterday, like you said, I did have a chance to go to the Memorial Hall, and I actually took the subway there to the nearby station, and I was walking through the neighborhood. And, you know, I'm not exaggerating when I say the neighborhood, really. All the people there are just, you know, they're
grieving.
Their faces are dark, and it's just, I had this chill. You have to go pass by the Korean University Hospital on the way to the Memorial Hall. And just, you know, it's kind of a long walk. And as I was walking there, there's a lot of banners there. There's a lot of ribbons being all over the neighborhood. And you can't help but just feel sad just walking through the neighborhood itself.
Mm-hmm. And that hospital is also where the bodies are being
carried
in.
Exactly. And just that walk itself. And as soon as I got to the Memorial Hall, of course, it was a completely different atmosphere there. And of course, like you said, I did have a chance to visit the site. So let's take a look. Now, just yesterday, another group memorial altar was set up in Ansan for the victims of the Sewol-ho ferry accident. With not enough room for the bodies to be received and processed, families with lost loved ones requested that the government provide a joint memorial altar. Following this request, the Gyeonggi-do Central Disaster and Safety Countermeasures Headquarters responded to the demand and set up a temporary joint memorial altar in Ansan.
Now, I'm currently at the Ansan Olympic Memorial Center, where all the students whose bodies have been recovered at the scene are being remembered here at the scene. Of course, family members, also friends, and just the citizens of Ansan just coming here to pay tribute to all the students who've lost their lives because of Sewol-ho ferry. And I'm here as well to remember the lives that were lost as well.
Now, as soon as people heard of this, many made their way out to pay their respects. Among the many who visited were government officials and well-known public figures such as actor couple Cha In-pil and Shin Hye-ra, who shared their heartfelt condolences with their bereaved families.
Just like everyone came together holding on to the last string of hope, I hope through this accident everyone can make changes and take more responsibility so that something like this never happens again.
At the joint memorial altar, pictures and name tablets of the 48 deceased Tangwon High School students and teachers were set up. Those at the memorial altar were in loss of words at the overwhelming sadness, and only a cold silence filled the air.
For the families, even I'm in so much pain, I can't even imagine how much pain they would be in. Despite the losses, I hope everyone can pull through this.
Currently, this memorial altar at the Olympic Memorial Hall is just a temporary one, and on April 29th, an official one will be set up at Ansan Harang Park. Everyone continues to hope and pray the search mission will quickly come to an end so they can pay their final respects to the deceased and lay them to rest.
It's so sad to think of how much pain they must have been in. It's such a great loss that so many young people were there. I hope in their next lives they can do everything they want and choose to.
Many were heartbroken to see the desperate yet touching smartphone messages from Tanwon High School students and their homeroom teacher. Che Hye-jung, who just started her teaching career in March, sent a message saying, "Don't worry, I'll let you all out first, then I'll follow," touching the hearts of many as she tried to save her students first. A memorial altar was set up at Dongguk University to remember its alumni, the late 24-year-old school teacher. Besides Dongguk University, other schools have also opened up their own memorial altars for their alumni who were killed in this accident. Along with Che, Nam Yun-chul is another teacher who lost his life in the accident while trying to safely rescue the students. His alma mater, Kumi University, set up a special memorial altar for him as well. Many of Nam's college juniors visited his memorial site to pay their respects. Nam was known to be a kind-hearted senior and school teacher. After receiving his bachelor's degree in English language and literature, he volunteered to teach at a small school in Taebudo Island, and many were heartbroken to see such a gentle and benevolent person lose his life.
"I recently found out that he was our university's senior. I think his brave and honorable act of sacrifice for his students really set a clear example of how our school and Korea's leaders should be."
Che and Nam were true teachers and heroes who stood their ground to save the students until the end. People across the country are all praying that those who lost their lives in this accident are in a better place. And with this, many continue to line up to say goodbye and pay their respects.
It's really difficult for us to just watch your report. Like, we can feel the heavy and solemn atmosphere that's going on at the memorial altars there. And how are these families coping there, and how are the visitors coping with the atmosphere there?
You know, I've been to the Mokpo Hanguk Hospital. I've seen the ambulances roll by. I've seen the family members as well. And this, to me, was a completely different atmosphere. And the fact that it wasn't just the family members, the fact that there were just, you know, just people of Ansan. Maybe these people didn't even know who the students were, who the teachers were. But I went there, and I remember going in there, and I saw the pictures of the students and teachers. It was very hard, even for me. And I didn't know any one of these kids. I didn't know any one of these the teachers. And you look at the faces and how young they are, and the futures were so bright for them. Maybe some of them wanted to be teachers. Maybe some of them wanted to be, you know, maybe broadcasters or journalists like us. But, you know, you start thinking about things like that.
Right,
exactly. And it must
have been really difficult, and especially seeing those faces. We have seen group memorial altars before, but nothing of this size. And to see those faces all lined up like that, and I'm sure it must have been really difficult for you. And a lot of people want to visit and pay their respects, but people have jobs to do, and so they can't. So, and there is a number that you can send messages to.
Exactly. And tell us about that. I know it was mentioned earlier on, but there is a number and mobile phone number that you can actually send text messages to. And of course, if you want to be one of the people that send the text messages, 010-9145-8879, as you see in the bottom here. And of course, you know, so many people have been sending in the message, and it's been overflowing with tons and tons of messages. So if you are one of the people that can't make it out there, you know, maybe a condolence message itself would be, you know, something that you might be interested in doing as well.
And a lot of people are offering help and support nationwide, and we hear that volunteers are at the altars as well.
I was very amazed at what kind of work these volunteers were doing. That tents were set up everywhere, food, drinks, and one, you know, the shuttle buses as well. One of the things that I was very amazed and very impressed was the fact that a lot of these taxi drivers, what they're doing is they're providing free rides to any of the family members or any one of the students at Tangwon High School who need to travel back and forth to the Memorial Hall and their houses as well. So they did a great job. The community themselves are doing a great job in providing for anything that they can do, whether it be just, you know, being there and helping out, giving out food or drinks, or like I said, giving rides to anyone affected by this incident.
Mm-hmm. And the city of Ansan, this place has been greatly affected by this disaster. They're doing more than just providing support for this group memorial altar. They're doing a lot more, in fact. Tell us more about
that. I know they're trying, you know, they're planning to set up a shrine. They're trying to set up something, a park to kind of, I guess, remember those lives that were lost in this tragic accident with the Seoho Ferry. And I think, you know, although it was the city of Ansan that was affected the most by this, because obviously most of the victims were from Tangwon High School, but I know from what I understand, Prime Minister Chung Hong-won is pushing forward to have a memorial hall set up all over the nation where everyone can easily visit these memorials, whether it be city halls or anywhere nearby in the centers in their town. So I think, you know, it's a well-deserved memorial hall, and we all do need to respect those that lost their lives.
Well, SJ, thank you for that report. It was really touching, and we wish that our hearts go to the families of the victims and all of those that are paying tribute there.
That's right.
Las pequeñas cosas. Lo que parecía no importante son las que más invaden mi mente al recordarte. Ojalá pudiera devolver el tiempo para verte de nuevo, para darte un abrazo y nunca soltarte. Más comprendo que llegó tu tiempo, que Dios te ha llamado para estar a su lado. Así él lo quiso.
Now that was a video sent by one of our viewers all the way from Colombia. We really appreciate it.
That's right. It was on our message board at arirang.co.kr. Now, it is the ninth day of recovery efforts and the mourning of the nation, or of the nation, for the lives that were lost on the Sewoto Ferry has been ongoing. Now, some of the most affected are the peers, but they're reaching out to do what they can.
Mm-hmm. In the midst of this chaos and sadness, young students are voluntarily participating in relief efforts, and this has touched the hearts of many people as well. Kim Chan-ju joins us with this story. Good morning.
Well, as you mentioned, Minjung, it was reported that 90% of relief goods to assist those mourning families on Jindo Island were actually sent by the teens around the ages of the Tanon High School students who were mostly affected by this tragic accident. And these young volunteers opted to give their time and effort to help and console those in need during these difficult times. So let's take a look. As the whole country is in a deep state of mourning with the recent sinking of the Seoro Ferry, people are looking for different ways to relay their messages of hope and support. This donation campaign started after one student asked a simple question: what can we do to help those in need?
My heart broke out when I heard students my age lost their lives on their way to Jeju Island. And so we decided to send in relief goods, and we further got this campaign out to others through our school broadcasting to bring in more supplies.
After hearing news about the Jeju Island banned ferry, Jeju Sehwa High School juniors took matters into their own hands, and the whole student body spearheaded a donation drive collecting about $1,000. Also, 29 juniors from Seoul Yongnak High School, hoping for the Danwon High School students on board the ferry to safely return back home, donated and sent various relief goods to the affected area.
I was very shocked and sad to hear students my age died because of this sinking. And after seeing so many victims' parents crying on the news, I deeply sympathized with them and decided to send these supplies.
Along with these carefully selected relief goods, the students also sent dozens of handwritten, encouraging and heartwarming letters.
I was grateful and proud of the students when they first suggested we start a donation drive. I thought to myself that these younger students are really setting an example for adults.
And these precious gifts from Yongnak High School students were sent to the families of the Danwon High School students in Ansan, who are still desperately awaiting news of their children at a gymnasium in Jindo. Just like this, many middle and high school students are coming together and collecting all kinds of relief supplies in the form of everyday goods and money through social media websites and other online activities. Many college students are also joining in this wave to help and console the victims of this tragic accident. Hanyang University students, who are like big brothers and sisters to Danwon High School students, decided to cancel the school's annual spring festival next month to mourn the lost lives and pray for the missing students to return to their families and friends.
Danwon High School, where students on the ferry are from, is very close to our school. The disaster is a loss for the entire country, but also for Ansan City. That's why we started this donation campaign, so that we can help even in the smallest way.
And many nameless generous donations and gifts have piled up inside the university's Sewol Ferry Sinking Fundraising Box.
I lived in Ansan for 21 years, and I was born here. I have a lot of friends who graduated from Danwon High School. It seems like something that could have happened to anyone, even my own family. So that's why I decided to take part in this campaign.
Hanyang University students are also planning to launch diverse fundraising campaigns to help the victims of the sunken Seoul ferry.
I'd like to help not only through donations, but find anything like volunteer work that I can do to help. I think grief is something that everyone should share.
While younger people carry on different types of relief efforts, online users have started their own movements by leaving responses on various porter fundraising sites. Hope Bridge Korea Disaster Relief Association was behind for various online fundraising work and delivering relief goods, ranging from the fire accident at Daegu's subway station, the shelling of Yeonpyeongdo Island, to the current Seoul ferry accident. As the name of the group suggests, the organization has become a bridge connecting generous givers with disaster victims who are in need.
Many local and international donors who can't physically help out on the site of the accident are asking what they can do to help the victims. Different people, ranging from young teens to middle-aged parents with children around the age of the student victims, are expressing their sympathy and willingness to offer assistance.
As soon as news of the Seoul ferry surfaced, the association sent necessary relief items such as blankets and boxes of bottled water given by local and international contributors, as well as people's encouraging letters to those affected. Some 70,000 people donated to the online fundraising that started last Thursday, April 17th. accumulation close to 300 million won, or $295,000.
The donated funds will be used in different ways to assist the survivors, deceased victims and their families, as well as members of the various rescue teams. We will place a special focus on using the donated money to provide psychological relief programs, as this accident caused a lot of trauma to those directly and indirectly involved.
Younger students and the rest of the Korean public are doing all they can to provide more comfort for those in need.
So help is coming in the form of money as well as relief supplies. Now the young students, they're sending relief supplies in out of no other motivation but an intrinsic desire to just help.
That's right. Many of them are actively involved in fundraising efforts, and also they are very active in organizing prayer services as well. There was actually an episode that was reported recently that three students who decided to get the good relief goods through social media decided to actually spend their own allowances for a cab ride to go down to Jindo Island to personally deliver goods for the mourning families.
Mm-hmm. And it was just amazing to see how the students just in their teens have started so many national campaigns to collect and send the relief goods to Jindo.
That's right. And I think one of the most actively participated areas, the southern resort island of Jeju. Now, we saw in the report about Jeju's Haewa School, high school students, and also Hanpyeong Hakdari middle and high school students and staffs, about 600 people, put together a donation of about $5,000 as well. So they're very much active in doing what they can.
It's encouraging to see that they are not just sitting around feeling helpless, but they want to be helpful. That's and nice. They want to turn this into something positive, which is good. Mm-hmm. Now, for some of our viewers who might be watching from home, if they want to take part in these campaigns, what can they do?
Well, Hope Bridge Korea Disaster Relief Association, from the report, is currently running its fundraising efforts campaigns through various portal websites, mobile messages, phone advance recorded systems, as well as money wiring systems as well. For those viewers for the overseas, you can also make a monetary support through an international donation account for that organization. And also separately, Jeolla Namdo's Community Chest of Korea has also set up a separate donation account for the victims of the ferry disaster.
Mm-hmm. Stories like this make you realize that adults have so much to learn mm-hmm. from these teenagers as well.
That's right. I think it's the fact that they are not only just concerned about it and they're taking an action from a small step, so I think it's a very significant move.
Thank you, Chanju.
Thank you.
Before we go, let's go back to Shin Se-min, who's at the memorial altar that has been set up in Ansan, the city that has been the most touched by the disaster. Se-min, could you fill us in the latest there?
Yes, Chinju. A total of 13,000 mourners have visited here just yesterday on Wednesday at Ansan Olympic Memorial Hall to pay their last tribute to those who have deceased. Lines of people reached all the way to the entrance of this memorial hall all day long yesterday. Mourners came in silence and said their last goodbyes offering white flowers. Even at the early hour today, you can see people coming in groups of three and four, writing letters and notes that dot the doors and walls outside the memorial hall. The local government here has also set up messaging service so that those who cannot come in person can send text messages of condolences. Yesterday, the system was overloaded with an outpouring of grief, with an estimate of over 20,000 text messages received. Moments ago, the messaging service was resumed, and the messages are being displayed as they come in on one of the screens here. And this has been Shin Se-min reporting from Ansan Olympic Memorial Hall.
Thank you, Se-min.
Thank you for that. And that brings us to the end of this edition of Korea Today. And we'll be back with more on the ferry disaster in about 3 hours' time. Please join us again.
Thank you for watching.
Goodbye.